This is so embarrassing. I like to be the like podcast person that like can quickly, you know, do the basic things like record their own audio.
People don't know how hard our lives are. You're just a podcaster. They don't know.
It's a miracle that anything ever gets recorded.
People always complaining about like their trade jobs and like backbreaking labor, but they don't know, man. They don't know this. It's tough on this time.
Yeah, they don't know the podcasters play. This is so embarrassing. I like to be.
So I'm at Slaboid T.
Alright, this is Shit Spouter 37.
This is Black.com Pilled.
This is the Fed Post.
With so your pod got suspended, right? Like your pod account on Twitter?
Yeah, no, that was a joke actually, that the Red Scare pod account got suspended, but that was like an old account that they didn't use, but everybody was like, oh my god, Red Scare. And so
right,
my brother was retweeting as a joke our old like podcast automated account from Patreon that was deleted like 2 years ago that we never used. So yeah, it was a joke. No, nothing got deleted with us.
Oh shit. Yo, when I saw yours go down and Red Scare, I got paranoid as fuck. I was like, oh shit.
I mean, I was paranoid as fuck like 2 weeks ago. I was like, it's all over. Like, I'm gonna get thrown off Patreon. Yeah. And I just started buying everything that I possibly ever wanted because I thought my Patreon flow would be cut off soon.
Right.
But then it didn't happen. And now I am just still on Twitter with this like high, and I kind of like wanted to be kicked off and it didn't happen.
Right. You can finally, yeah. There was that feeling of like, all right, well, I could just say whatever because it's all over now. It's about to end. Everything's about to end. But it just kind of normalized. I mean, I changed.
Yeah, because like 3 weeks ago, they were saying, you know, 75,000 Americans are domestic terrorists that have to be reeducated.
Yeah,
and exactly. I was like, fuck my Patreon. I really want to buy some perfume. Then it didn't happen. And everything's fine now.
Right.
But I really wanted a break from Twitter, man. I really wanted to get kicked off, and it didn't happen. And now Twitter just keeps getting worse and worse. Like, AOC is the star since Trump is gone, and every day is just about what AOC does.
Oh,
and man. Dasha's gone now, and
she got suspended?
No, she deactivated because of haters, and she's sick of it. But yeah, it's like when Dasha's gone, it's like when Courtney Thorne Smith left Melrose Place. There's like not a main character anymore.
There's a dearth, yeah.
Yeah, I'm like, is it supposed to be me? Who's supposed to be the main character now? I really want to get kicked off so I can like read some books and shit and like live some normal life, but it's not happening.
You wouldn't go like, you go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, AOC kind of taking the place of Trump almost in some ways is kind of like trying to get like a, you know, maybe a somewhat popular like side character to take over and like a leading role, and it just isn't working really. It's
people just love talking about everything she does, and like I feel to a degree immune to it because I'm a straight man, and like I'm a gay man rather, and so I find her just repulsive, but like straight guys like kind of want to fuck her, which I understand because she has a slutty presence. And
you think she does?
Yeah, she has a slutty presence, and she says all this bullshit, which is, you know, obviously intended as a provocation. And, you know, all of her liberalism is totally fake. She does have a kind of like 6 out of 10 kind of like slutty presence, which attracts the straight guys. And she's just asking for it.
Jack, you're out of your depth here. Hold on. Wait a minute. You're out of your depth. You can't be handing out numbers like that. Wait a minute.
6 is generous. I mean, as a gay man, I think she's like a 3 or a 4. Oof. I mean, she's thin. That's the main thing. Oof. It's like because she's thin and she has like big hooters, wears red lipstick, the media covers her nonstop.
I will say, I think she has a very cheap attractiveness, right? Like, it's not that kind of like well built house kind of thing.
I mean, she's literally someone you would hook up with at a bar.
Yeah. She's not sturdy.
That's the attraction there, is that like she's just so cheap. But she is the focus of the entire, this fucking idiot is the focus of the entire American political system.
She just, she gives me more a vibe of like, she's like the good wife, you know what I mean? Like very wholesome and like, you know what I mean? Like,
oh, she's
like,
not wholesome. Oh, she's no,
no, but she gives that vibe, you know what I mean? Like,
she's a hoe. Even when she was describing like her made up rape story, like it was different with her because like you can tell she's the type of person that enjoys sex. Like most women don't enjoy sex, but AOC, I feel like, does. She's a little slut.
Hey.
So like her little rape story. You know, it was different because it was erotic for her telling that at the little podium. It's just like, I understand, like there are certain men that I see that are just like slutty, like Dan Crenshaw with the eye patch. Like he just needs to be in porn. I don't know what political purpose he serves. But he needs to be bottoming in hardcore gay porn.
Slutty pirate, like slutty handicapped pirate.
Yeah, he needs to be bottoming. He needs to be getting plowed. That's what he's supposed to do instead of politics.
It's wild. I never thought about it like that.
I never thought of it that way. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, she's become the focal point of everything. I mean, I don't know. I used to think, yeah, I mean, look, I was just a regular lib. I thought she was hot. But, you know, we've said it before, but like, yeah.
Dude, straight men have such low standards. Right, if that right. is hot.
All right.
Like, if that is right, hot. All right, all right. Then
you got to even know. There's like, something
if that
for her
donkey
being
face.
Like a, being in a position of authority, it like lends something to that. It adds a couple points though.
What are you?
Well, yeah,
because
like anybody in a position of authority is hot, you know.
CWH sounds like he's a sub or something.
Whoa, I switch.
I mean, it's just like the kind of like, you know how if you have a teacher that's like slightly more passably attractive than any other teacher, they become really hot.
That's totally true. That's very true. You know, that's very true.
That's the AOC phenomenon. Is that number one? She's thin. She has breasts. She wears the ironic red lipstick, the Riot Girl red lipstick. Number two, it's, you know, such a low bar that she has to meet to be like the kind of like sex symbol. And she knows how to manipulate Twitter and the media. I think she's genuinely stupid. I don't think she does it consciously, but I think that she has an instinct, a theater kid instinct to know like what boundaries to cross on Twitter to make herself the topic of the day every day.
Yeah,
she's infuriating.
Yeah,
I had never heard of her until November 2018, whenever the squad materialized.
Right.
Yeah. Were y'all like Bernie people or something? Like I had never heard of Bernie Sanders until like November 2018 either.
Really?
I didn't hear of Bernie Sanders until Red Scare.
I heard of him like 2015 in that run. That's when I heard about him a little bit before, but he was just kind of like on the margins. You know, he's just like, oh, he did some cool shit in Vermont. Like, you know, he's just.
It's kind of a little boutique, you know, like kind of, a little authentic guy.
Yeah, cookie grandpa shit.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Like the worst thing ever to happen to American politics. I think he's so repellent because he's just this kind of like holding tank for people who realize, who are we're smart enough to realize that something is wrong, deeply wrong, with the treatment of Trump and the stranglehold of the media, but they don't want to alienate their social circle. So they go into this little safe holding tank of Bernie Sanders, you know,
right.
And we see the whole like online left like floundering now because it doesn't have him as a sort of like symbol of like, well, actually, I'm a good person. It was just a way of like signifying that you're a good person.
Yeah. And he's a holding tank in general. Like, even if that's not what your deal is, like if it's not a moralism thing for you, if you were just like, well, maybe like I could just have like some healthcare or something that's going to change. Like, he obviously wasn't going to provide any change. And so like, he's just a holding tank for dissident energy to just cycle it right back to like those ghoulish fucks at the DNC.
Dude, I threw a vote at him last January. Just because, you know,
primary,
I will only ever vote Republican for my entire life, but I did throw a vote at Bernie Sanders just, you know, as a symbolic thing in Texas, but it didn't matter because it was already rigged.
Right. This was in Texas primary?
Yeah, it was the Texas primary. And like, I voted for Trump twice. I voted for Trump, you know, in the initial primary in 2015. I was there from the start. I voted for him happily in the general election. And then, yeah, I threw a symbolic vote at Bernie Sanders because there was that moment where it was like kind of it seemed like something exciting might happen or something different.
Right.
Before they like cracked down and they were like, no, this weakened at Bernie's Joe Biden puppet.
Yeah.
Is going to be the person.
Yeah. I threw him a vote in 2015 in the New York primary. Back then, that's the only vote I've really done. There was one time I was about to vote for Obama, but the line was mad long, and I was just like, well, fuck this. I mean, he's gonna win in my state anyway, whatever. But like,
maybe he might shake up the DNC in some type of way, like, because it's gonna show them fucking him, and people like maybe be like, oh, this is like just what always happens. And that again is just false hope that like he provided. That's kind of just this whole fucking shtick is just providing false hope for people.
I never understood the appeal from the start, you know, because I only found out about him later. I literally got through the whole 2016 election without knowing who Bernie Sanders was.
That's kind of
impressive. And Trump was just magically elected because I wanted him elected. And I had never heard of Bernie Sanders. And then later I started hearing him referred to on podcasts and stuff.
I only voted for Bernie and Trump. That's the only people I voted for in my life. And Trump for president, Bernie in the primary. But yeah, I mean, Bernie, he really is despicable. I mean, I really hate the fucking guy at this point.
Oh, he like it's for girls. Like the whole Bernie Sanders thing is just.
Yeah, for the reasons you said, pretty much the reason why I despise him now.
Yeah.
See what you hear.
Looks everybody? Like my health check is still going, but I can hear everybody.
This podcasting thing looks like my fitness pal. I'm like, what's the health check? It's like checking my heart.
The health check says I have diabetes.
Yeah, you know, I don't want to find out that I have diabetes yet.
Yeah, no, I just avoid the doctor. If I think anything serious is wrong, I'm just like, all right, just stuff that down. Don't think about it.
Yeah, I started hating doctors when I turned about like 27. And I was like, I don't want to know. I don't want to know about the AIDS. I don't want to know about skin cancer. Now I especially don't want to know because COVID has turned me into a total like Russian drunk, you know, and I just like there's nothing. I can't bear reality without drinking a little.
I'm supposed to go to the doctor just to get a lecture about how the lifestyle that I'm living is just not healthy. Like, yeah. I don't think so, man. I'd rather just keep doing it.
Well, how old are y'all?
I'm 23.
I'm 28.
26. Damn. So y'all are really young. I got a melanoma at 23, so I already had skin cancer by then.
Oh, shit.
And so I don't take money or like anything seriously at all because I've like almost died so many times.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, I've had a bunch of health scares too. When I was like 18 years old, I was in the hospital for like a month and a half and like ICU for 3 weeks and shit. Like they brought
I almost got my leg chopped off in Lake Waco the weekend after I graduated from high school with my bachelor's degree that took 6 years to get. my all important English degree.
Well, that's good because I feel like it can help in far as like you just don't give a fuck anymore. Like you just say whatever. You're like, what, you know?
Look, I'm glad I finished college, but also if you try to get like a sort of manual labor job, they won't hire you because you're overqualified if you have a degree. So you have to like lie about having a degree in order to get any kind of job like that. Like my last job, I absolutely hated and I was looking for any kind of like way out. And I was applying to like moving companies and stuff. They wouldn't hire me because I put that degree on the resume.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
I can imagine that. Yeah. But I mean, I feel like it's got to be liberating, at least in terms of like, you know, just as far as like woke schooling or whatever, all that stuff like that really can't faze you at that point. I mean, like, what's that mean to you? Like, it's already trivial, but it must become like even more trivial after that.
I don't know. I had fun in college. I liked college because I like having like assignments. I like having reading assignments and then being forced to write like essays and, you know, formulate thoughts about it. I would still be in school if somebody was paying for it. I really enjoyed it, especially like community college, which I went to for a long time. But it's the absolutely ridiculous debt that, you know, as an 18-year-old, I didn't understand what I was signing up for. They just hand you these papers and they're like, oh, you'll be able to pay this off when you get a job. And then I'm $100,000 in debt for an English degree.
Yeah.
And like half of a graduate degree.
Like, you have to go to college. State school. This is what everyone's doing. Go ahead and sign these papers because you don't want to be like not like everyone else and go to school and do your thing.
Yeah, you're just like in the pipeline, like a lo-fi Republican. Shout out to him. I fucking love his account. He was just like, it's weird, like these kids can't even do a grocery budget and they're just told like, yeah, so you're going to be in this much debt for this much and, you know, 6% interest on all this shit. And like, you just figure it out from there. It's like, what?
You know, when Me Too was kicking off and all of this obsession with rape and exploitation was occurring in the media, I was like, what happened to me and what they do to like 18-year-olds straight out of high school, signing you up for massive life ruining loans when you have no idea what things cost and what money is.
Right,
so much more rape. I would rather be literally raped than,
sign that paper. It's for life. Yeah, it's for life. And like they prey on people for like military recruitment, like young ass kids that are just like fucked up economically. And it's just like, yeah, that's super exploitative. Like, yeah, they know you don't know. I mean, that's the perfect age to get them because they don't know. And like my parents too, they're just like, yeah, this is all we know. They're immigrants. So they're just like, this is the only way. And I just over time, I'm just like, you know, I'm starting to think this shit might just be a fucking scam. Like, I don't know. I don't know if the return on investment really matches up with what you're putting in the long term.
I mean, my parents didn't know. Like when they went to school in the 70s, it was free. Like college literally used to be basically free. Like,
and it was career oriented, like trade, like job oriented. It was meant to like actually prepare you for a job market and not just prepare you to have lofty ideas about humanity.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, the last time I was like in a college, in like a classroom, like my professor was literally telling us, like, just so you know, like, this doesn't necessarily mean you're gonna get a job. And I'm just like sitting there in the classroom, just like, we're at the point where like this guy is saying this stuff. Like, you know, what is that saying about
baby? No refunds.
Yeah, no, exactly. What does that say about the entire outlook at this point? Like,
that was what they said to me. You know, I didn't have any like career outlook. I just sort of wanted to become the next Camille Paglia, which is not something you can do outside of the academic system as it was structured in the 70s. Like she got through at a particular time. You can't do that anymore. And all of the exhausted interns and everything, yeah, they were all just like, there's no place for you after you finish this degree. And that combined with the overwhelming feminist conservatism caused me to not finish it. I wish I'd finished the master's degree just for the hell of it, but I just like had a job editing erotica and I was like, I can't finish this.
Master, yeah, I mean, I didn't finish my master's either. I mean, it's wild because, like, they charge, like, double per credit, you know what I mean? And now that that's the new standard for a bachelor's, like, whatever the bachelor's worth as a market signal in the labor market, like, now that's what a master's is worth. And it's, like, it's funny, too, because I'm thinking about, like, what Alex G was saying when she was on here. Like, now they're kind of doing this in high school now where you're getting, like, these liberal arts lofty bullshit that you know is not going anywhere. Now they're doing it in high school and, like, lower levels because, like, there's no jobs for anybody. Realistically, I mean, like, all that shit is fucked, so it's like
yeah, so the simultaneously every, you know, it requires a master's degree to work at McDonald's, and also the degree will prevent you from getting hired at McDonald's. Exactly. And, you know, it's
exactly
such bullshit. Exactly. But I genuinely enjoyed school because I like reading, and you know, I just went forward in it because I'm a person who was like, I enjoy reading books. This is the path forward, and that was basically the extent of that thought process.
Yeah, they sort of like they put you in a bind either way. But I don't know. I mean, I don't know what it would be like to be a kid right now. I mean, I'm like still pretty young. I mean, I'm 28, but like to be a kid right now must be fucking wild. This shit must
You'd be so twisted weird. Up, so fucked in the head.
You'd be on TikTok.
Well, you're sitting in one of those little fucking booths Plexiglass. In a classroom. Yeah. Like Layla was posting. She
Christ, yeah, man. I saw that shit. What the fuck, yo?
I mean, it's just, I mean, honestly, like, I don't even know that we have to imagine that hard like what being a kid is right now, because we're all basically doing the same fucking thing.
We're all kids, yeah.
Yeah, because nobody ever grows up. Nobody yeah. except the lower classes has children. So everybody else is stuck in this eternal urban millennial Uber Eats little like empty lifestyle,
right? And kids, not only are the upper classes like not having children and these like bourgeois people, like they also don't have a need to grow up because they're so sheltered from most everything. Like they don't experience much like close proximity to scarcity ever. They don't really have a question like what's gonna happen for how they're gonna be getting money or food next week. They don't ever have to like work closely with people who are different with them in order to achieve a goal together. Like,
well, hold up, there's the scarcity of having to wait a whole week for the new episode of WandaVision and the Mandalorian. Excuse you very fucking much. All right. And yeah, sometimes they don't bring my pad CU in time, so that also we're all, you know, have our own crosses to bear.
Yeah, and they're not bringing back my girl Gina Carano either, so fuck them.
Okay, well, I don't. Okay, really fast. I'm in a vulnerable state right now, and I don't know if I'm ready to talk about that.
Okay, I was like tangentially aware of what happened with her. What's her deal? She got fired for saying what? Like,
she's a hot
despicable
broad.
Claims. That's what the media calls it. Her despicable conspiracy theory claims that masks are annoying and the election was rigged.
Oh yeah, my yeah. god, that's what they got her
they,
for
they always use yeah. the word despicable, like she's like talking about like the Jewish question or something.
They said abhorrent too, like Disney yeah. put out a thing, they're like despicable and abhorrent remarks, and they're like today was the last straw, and their only tweet from that day that they posted that was a tweet that was like a word search and it just said Epstein didn't kill himself, and that was the only tweet that day. These people god. Are sick.
These people are fucking sick. No, the funniest thing, I think I forget who shared this, but I saw like a post that was like, I mean, I was under the impression the main thing was her doing the very normie thing of going like, look, you know, making a Nazi Germany comparison, right? Yes. And being like, being a Trump supporter is like being a Jew in the
But that was in November. Like, that was months ago.
Oh,
but also, so Libs literally are Nazis. Like, I'm doubling down on calling Libs Nazis.
Speak on.
I don't care. Like, I call them Nazis left and right because it's totally yeah. true. Like, you know, I'm not going to wait, you know, until it's all over to correctly classify them as Nazis. I like throwing the word right back at them.
For real, because well, that's what I was when the time
and,
comes.
And that's what I was going to say is that the day she gets you know, shit canned or whatever, number two on trending is her, and then number three on trending is Josh Howley is a Nazi. you know what I mean? So it kind of, I mean, that's all you fucking need to know about the whole fucking thing.
Yeah, I mean, and then meanwhile they released Mulan, and Mulan was like filmed in the mountains right next to like the Uyghur death camps in China. China, supposedly.
You don't need to do the hard R.
But like, I'm so checked out because like, you can't like point out lib hypocrisies anymore and have it mean anything.
Yeah, yeah, for real.
The whole last year was one giant like black hole psyop to see how far they could go in subverting everything.
They just keep chugging all along. Common
sense. Oh yeah.
So it's just like all I can do is check out and like not really comment on it. And you know, if you are not aware that libs are the Nazis and they are the evil people in society right now, then there's no hope for you.
Oh yeah, because absolutely. All the shit they said about Me Too and BLM and kids in cages, all that shit. Biden, them going so hard for Biden is a direct like refuting all that shit that they said. All of it. He's building new camps.
Well, and the sort of like talking heads, like Facts and Logic, Ben Shapiro, conservatives that kind of like take the lib premises seriously, you know, that's their mistake. Like Me Too was never about any kind of justice for anyone.
Right.
Black Lives Matter was never about any kind of justice for anyone. That's all fake. You have to reject the entire structure. You can't be like, oh, they have some good points. No, it's all fake.
You can't debate them assuming their premises because the premises are bullshit. They don't mean it. They don't care.
The premises are just like to acknowledge the validity of that is to 100% enter into like the arena of them and allow them to be like holding you morally hostage, right? Because it's all just kind of like this permutation of the whole like, you know, pro-life implying that you're anti-life I believe that Black Lives Matter, right? And it's like, okay, well, is that like a demonstration of your support for like a network of organizations, or is that like the sentiment itself, right? And like the second you like lend any kind of validity to their just basic framing, then you're just like allowing that gun to be placed to your head.
You're allowing the virus to get in, just as how the biggest shocker twist ending of 2020 was when they revealed that racism was the real virus. You're allowing the virus to get into your head if you give them any credibility. And like I get it, most people that are like casually supporting the lib agenda are like normal people who don't really think about politics or culture that much. They just think they see the words Black Lives Matter and they're like, obviously Black Lives Matter. But like the people in our little corner of Twitter that like kind of like know what's going on and understand it and are classified as stigmatized as conspiracy theorists and everything for understanding how this propaganda works, which is obvious if you have two eyes and two ears. the way that the, you know, Blue Checks unironically post those charts where the COVID cases go down, they plummet immediately as soon as Biden is elected. And they're like, I can't believe the COVID case is good. That's like what most people think. And I get it. Like most people don't want to like stir things up in their personal lives, also just like dumb and victims of like the people in control right now are the dumbest people who have ever existed in any society.
Did you see the clip of Pelosi coming out to the podium doing her like her act of like being mad at Mitch McConnell? Did you see that clip at all?
No, I don't pay attention to anything. I just see like I have the words like AOC muted. I did that little app that blocks the 800 New York Times accounts. I try to I try to make my feed like kind of as free of the fake news media as possible, but I still absorb bits of it. And like, I just wish people would see the larger picture and unplug, because the news on both sides is a soap opera without art that gets you worked up about every little thing the libs do, and has no payoff. And there's never any like climactic, you know, season finale. Like the biggest thing that ever happened in the way of climactic season finale was Trump getting elected. But that doesn't happen every day. And like the kind of standard conservatives tune in, they think they think that they should be listening to all of this stuff rather than pulling out, seeing the larger cultural wave, cultural movement for what it is. I don't know how to help people at this point. I'm just very tuned out.
I feel that. Yeah. No, that's probably the move. I mean, like, yeah, of all the like culture war stuff that I think it's very good to tune out. I try to tune out a lot. I don't know about this Karate Girl, whatever her name is, that Disney canceled. Like, I don't know. Well, I saw that. I just like didn't pay attention because I'm just like, fuck it. I don't care. Like, you know what I mean? It's just all part of the same like frenzy media. You know what I mean? Like, just who gives a fuck? Whatever. Like, you know what I mean? I mean,
I'm not going to listen to AOC doing psychosexual made up rape claims every day. Like, I'm just that's not gonna be a part of my daily routine. I refuse.
Participate. Like, yeah, to go deep into it and to figure out like each one of her like lies or each one of her angles. I'm not gonna do that. Like, I just know like it's bullshit. I mean, if I see BLM or Me Too or whatever, or like, you know, whatever in your bio, like, I just assume you're dumb. I really do. Assume you're dumb.
And Me Too is all bullshit. Like, I remember when Me Too was starting, like the Wignats and the like racists were like happy because they thought like, really? Oh, the corrupt Jews of Hollywood will finally get their come up.
Really?
And I was like, it's like the stupidest thing I've ever heard.
Yeah, that's retarded.
And it's like, no, anytime you kind of like feed into this current crucible Salem witch trials, female psychosexual insanity that we've been living under for the last 12 years. Anytime you feed into it, it's bad news. Yeah,
that's the thing. If it appeared in like Profiles and Times magazine or whatever, that means it's not a threat to them, right? That alone should tell you like, all right, this is not really much of a hindrance to them. And okay, so that goes into the thing of like the lib spite thing that we were supposed to talk about. Like, so like, I guess that's the question is like, how much of it is like, you know, whatever the libs do, just do the polar opposite, or just, you know, just sort of like just assume everything they do is tainted. You know what I mean? Like, how much validity is there to that? Because I think there is. I think there is literally some validity. I think it is that simple to a big degree. I think
you can get a pretty accurate gauge of where you should be on the cultural and political spectrum by glancing at what the New York Times headlines are and discounting it as entirely fake.
Exactly.
You know, because I feel bad. I'm at the point of like my hatred of the libs and the bugs and the normies has turned into a kind of pity because I have to like see them every day. I have to like talk to them. Like, these are people, you know, that just aren't very smart.
Sure. Yeah.
And they'll like, I went to the like refrigerator at my workplace and they had like the New York Times article about like double masking will save you printed out and taped on the refrigerator. And it's like, I get it. Most people just are really dumb and conformist, especially women. And they just want to do what's right and what they think will make people like them.
Right.
And
exactly.
That's how we're in the position we're in now.
Exactly.
Where there's total fascism, total censorship, total just disgusting overreach of the most ridiculous form of liberal power, all mixed up with the psychosexual insanity of Me Too. And there's nothing you can do if you don't realize that it's all fake.
Right. Yeah, I don't think the libs themselves, like the average everyday lib, is that like evil or whatever. Like, they're just stupid, right? They're just naive, or they're just like, oh, it's
better to
go along.
They've never, you know, they've never had to experience ostracization, right? Like, or any consequences for anything they've ever thought.
Exactly.
And they're just fed this narrative that actually they're the underdog, even though you know,
right,
all of the most objectively powerful people in the entire world, to an unprecedented degree that's never occurred in human history, they're all on their side. They still think like, oh, but if I do this like little pithy gesture towards Black lives and trans lives, they think it's all real. It's really sad.
Yeah. I think they just blatantly simp for elite politics. So like, maybe they themselves aren't really the object of your ire or whatever. Like, maybe they're not the point isn't to, like, you know, they're not the focal point of it. But the things that they care about, That's the clear thing that you should be opposing. Like, they clearly have whatever the elite tells them to believe. That's what they're supposed to believe. So,
well, I think women have a caring maternal instinct that is manipulated and distorted by liberalism, and yeah. where they don't have children to care for anymore. So it's all of these abstract ideals that they're fed by the media. And women, you know, show me a woman that doesn't like censorship and I'll show you a liar, because women love censorship. they love control. They love everything being organized like a kindergarten. That's their instinct. Okay.
Okay. You're right.
It serves a purpose, caring for children, but there aren't any children anymore. So they just care for these abstract ideals of like monstrous, like Samantha Pritchard, like men in wigs.
Well, they're all spinsters that like would otherwise be taking care of their parents, but they're not taking care of their parents because they hate their fucking family. So like they're like spiritual old convalescent care parents is like Nancy Pelosi, and like
yeah, they don't really hate their family. They've just been conditioned to think that they hate their family, and they're just too dumb, because women will not do anything to risk being a social outcast.
Right. Like, no, yeah, yes. Absolutely. That's a big thing that people forget is like, you know, they care more about the social order, because back in the day, that was a big thing. If you went outside of the social order, you'd be out. And if you're a woman, you can't fend for yourself. You're fucked. So that's a big, evo psych drive that people forget. But I mean, it's true. It's real. That's really what it is.
I think that feminine power usually like rests more in like the social kind of sphere for sure. And everything too, which is also why like you get no kind of like formalism or anything like that. It's all these fucking like streams you're talking about from AOC of just kind of like talking about all these traumas and talking about all this stuff that's going on, and it's basically you're just entering into a hall of mirrors, right? It's like dating a psycho ex-girlfriend.
Well, the Me Too stuff is literally like Victorian like psychosexual insanity. That's like it's just like you allow women freedom and they come up with these like crazy like romance stories that they live under, and it's like a Victorian comic where they would like show like women reading and then going insane from like thinking everything's real, and that's what Me Too is.
Do you think that AOC has convinced herself of her account of the Capitol protest?
I think she thinks everything's real. I think that she thinks that everything she does is real. Like millennials have a certain sincerity, a certain Puritan sincerity to everything that they do, which is why we'll never get out of this mess until the millennial generation dies out or loses power, because it's just like Puritan insanity. Kamala Harris, I don't believe like the Kamala or like the Hillary like drone queen types. Like, I don't think they believe the shit that they are forced to shill.
Yeah. No, I know. I think they're like, and maybe I wouldn't even say like in a negative way. Like they're just like honest political actor, or I'm not honest, but I mean like effective political actors that are like clearly just instrumentalizing that.
And look, I'll take that. I always prefer that. I prefer the Hillarys 100%. Who will like cynically press the drone button and like say whatever they have to say. I prefer that to the AOCs who are in this
crucible
Tituba witch hunt insanity, and they genuinely believe it. Millennials genuinely believe that everything's real. They believe transgenderism is real. They believe Black Lives Matter is real. You know, they believe COVID is real. They're just very empty and lost and susceptible to any kind of propaganda because they have no religion, no family. They're just, it's a terrible generation.
Well, and it's like you were talking about like sincerity. I think that's like, I don't know, whenever I think about that, whenever I think of just horrible, destructive millennial sincerity, I just think of like Hannah Gadsby. I'm just picturing like Hannah Gadsby, just fat lesbian Hannah Gadsby like burning someone at the pyre.
You see, like, lesbians are so dumb that they, like, butch lesbians are being eliminated because they believe transgender propaganda and think they're all men now.
Right.
that's how fucking dumb they are.
You know, okay, this is something I've
wondered. The funniest part is that, like, that's accurate of, like, a handful of people I know in real life.
Yeah, I mean, like, if you believe that you can, like, switch genders and you don't understand that, like, butch lesbians are a particular thing and you will never be a man, like, you're susceptible to any kind of propaganda.
Right,
they're the first to go.
It gets to where we're getting to this point where it's like, to try to usurp these, like, gender norms and try to be, like, subversive and be like, oh, well, actually, like, you can be whatever you want to be. The way that they're doing that is, like, through just further reifying gender norms and just doing, like, gender essentialism. Like, oh, well, like, if you're a butch lesbian that wears, like, men's clothes, well, actually, you're just a transgender guy now. So, like, I mean, you like boy activities, you like boy clothes, you're transgender. Dude,
this is what I'm saying. This is what I'm saying. I saw that video. I don't know if you guys saw it, where it was like this transgender parent was talking to the kid and was like, so you're like a transgender boy. They're talking to their kid, like, really young kid, like 5 or younger.
A little girl.
Yeah, it was just like, I don't know if you guys saw it, but yeah, it was just like, oh, so do you like doing like quiet girly activities or like going acting crazy, you know, and rambunctious like, yes, a boy or whatever.
Crazy shit.
And I was just like, it's what evil. The fuck are you talking
I've never seen anything so bizarrely didactic and conservative as the 2010s transgender ideology, where they will tell everyone, and especially children, that if they cross the normative gender lines and any of their interests or whatever, that they're actually born in the wrong body. And it's just absolutely bizarre. And that is, you know, the importance of the transgender ideology to the overall impact of 2010's liberalism preparing us for the COVID New World Order. Like, that was the most important step of it, where you create fear in regular people to state something as essential and fundamental as the reality of gender. And these people, you know, I'm so glad that I'm not a child now, because these people would have, these 30-year-old guidance counselors, these women and everything, would have told me that I was a girl born in a boy's body because I liked the girl stuff and I liked hanging out with girls when I was a kid. And it's so insanely puritanical and conservative, that ideology.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Step backwards. Like, if we got to a point where with like gender studies and stuff, they think that gender is a malleable thing and you can just cross gender lines, then why the fuck do you want to cling to genders in general? Why don't you just do away with the concept of gender and just go back to just general sex? Like, you're biologically this, you're biologically that, and you can act and present and identify however the fuck you want to.
The solution is very simple, is that you can be a gender non-conforming person without clinging to this extremely conservative ideology where you gain power through demanding everyone change language, change reality. Like, like, gender non-conforming people have known this since the beginning of time. I'm one of them. Like, I feel like there's more truth to the Victorian idea of homosexuality, where you were just like, you had a woman's brain and a man's body or something. Like, that's more informative and like true than this like insane thirst for power that you see in the current gender identity stuff.
I mean, I think that just like one of the biggest parts of it that I can like totally understand. Like, I can't relate with any of this as far as like, you know, my own experience and relationship with my own gender or anything. But like, it's just opening the door and kicking people into just like the small closed off cell of just a complete neurotic existence, letting like your brain be the master of yourself. And that is like the modern curse. And like, that was already everything around us was already a slope into being like, you know, I mean, it's just all the David Foster Wallace shit, right? Like everything was a slope into just being stuck in your mind and being alone with your own malignant thoughts And now like there's people actively pushing young children into that way. And like, and honestly, like, yeah, like it's counter to the whole idea of, you know, like Western idea of just like grit and will to actualize whoever you want to be. But like the idea that like who I am isn't completely within like the, isn't completely dictated by like, you know, my thoughts and efforts and everything is, I mean, it's fucking completely true, but it also is comforting to a certain way because like there is some immutable characteristics of me that are bolted down. You know what I mean? There is, that is like a type of order, right? And to be completely alone in the fucking ocean and you just have just vaporous thoughts as the only thing, as the only force is like, that's nothing. Like you're just a silly putty person. And like, and then yes. And then the second power comes into this equation. Like come the fuck on, come the fuck on.
Yeah. People need to be rooted into their like material surroundings and reality. Like it's otherwise people are just completely unhinged and living in just like hyper reality, which everyone already is, but just even more so. And this is just like another step in that. It's just like fully moving in everyone into the realm of ideological and like to where they just think that like the reality they experience is the reality that's in their head versus like their head making sense of the material conditions that's around them.
Yeah, and we talked about it on the show before, but like especially with the lockdowns now, it's just like getting lost in your own head is just like, you know, obviously it's good to be introspective, but everybody who's lived long enough knows that that can be a trap at a certain point. And like I'm guilty of it myself, and like, yeah, you just get too deep in it. And that's how you end up in these identity holes. And like, I don't even care that much about my identity, but like you can, I mean, that's the thing. You can just end up too deep in it and you just kind of like, you don't even know what the fuck you're talking about anymore. Like you're just overanalyzing things that maybe, you know, you don't need to, it's not necessary. And you just kind of,
well, that's an interesting, tied entirely to your mind, to your thoughts and like what your mind thinks you are, then it can change at any given time. And there's no, like, there's no concrete, there's no consistency there. And so absolutely, there's nothing for you to like root yourself to at all.
Absolutely.
Well, no, and that's the thing is, yeah, you said for a second there, and I'm not like grilling you. I'm just like kind of trying to like expand on like a point you kind of brought up, which is like, yeah, you don't think about your identity that much. And it's like, I think that's fucking normal. I think that's fucking normal, right? Like your identities are for the most part, I mean, overwhelmingly, like, assigned to you.
Yeah,
right?
Totally.
How other people perceive you.
Yeah, exactly. And so, like, it's kind of like we're in, it, I almost feel like we're in this waiting room as a society where we're almost, like, functioning and operating as if we've, like, reached past this singularity where we all just, like, ascend past our physical forms. Right. We all just exist as pure consciousness.
Transhuman.
And we're just, yeah, exactly. We're simply just, you know, free-floating clouds of ideas, right? Except we're not, right? Because right. Like because the means to do so doesn't exist. And so we're all just, so what that looks like is everyone just like sitting in studio apartments, just like just levitating, receiving less. I wish, man.
Since they're dumb, they latch onto this idea that there's always more progress to be done. Like every big victory for libs, you know, is immediately forgotten because they have this idea that there's so much left to do, because that's how they,
right,
the Democrat Party continues to operate, because they have to create new minorities to stand up for new causes in order to remain profitable.
Yep.
So they give the illusion that no progress is ever made. And this, you know, you see, as soon as gay marriage was passed, they invented transgenderism as the new cause.
Yep.
And the average lib just thinks that, like, if only people would cooperate, then we would have utopia. And like the COVID, the COVID mindset for the average lib is that there's this like party of like,
Jack, you cut out.
Can you hear me now?
No, I heard him.
I still
heard
him.
I heard him.
The saw cut out.
The COVID mindset for libs is that, you know, there's this enemy comprised of like Trump and like made up like white supremacists that have prevented us from getting back to normalcy. Like they really believe in this. They think that there are these people standing in the way of the COVID stuff. And if only everyone would cooperate and wear two masks, then we would be able to get back to normal. And, you know, it just keeps multiplying, adding onto itself, fractalizing.
Some lib the other day told me, like, with COVID stuff, they were like, yo, so, like, just so you know, like, we're only just now starting to put together a plan to tackle COVID. Like, we had a whole year of Trump and incompetent people being in office where they didn't even do anything about it or think about it. So, like, you know, you really start to see the progress now that we have some people that are really brain dead trying to fix it. It's like, you fucking brain dead motherfuckers.
No, it's all
really sad.
Yeah, it's
they
all
really, you know, the only thing that gives me hope is that like libs and normies will always corner me into uncomfortable conversations about COVID where I'm just like nodding. And but like they seem to think that there will be some return to normalcy at some point. And I can't start the whole conversation about like, no, sweetie, this has all been fake and it's never going back to normal. Like,
there's no normal to return to.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's all elite signifiers, like the double mask shit and the woke shit is all just like, you know, they have to move the goalposts because if everybody catches on, then it's not really a small niche thing anymore. It's not really like a exclusive thing. So they have to keep moving it. It's like the gay marriage to the trans thing, like all this shit, the double masking, like they need to keep moving it because, you know, that's the whole point. The point is to have an utopia itself. I mean, who has time to think about utopia? Most people are thinking about how to fucking survive the next day. So thinking about utopia is really like some elite bougie shit. And like, that's what that is. That's what all that shit is all these things of like, well, how do we get even more pristine utopia? Like they're thinking about heaven and utopia and nobody's anywhere near that. And that's why it's like, you know, if you're not thinking that level, then you're not really a good person. It's like, damn, man, nobody has time to think about this shit. People are trying to fucking figure out their own life, like for tomorrow.
Motherfucker,
like,
what heaven? I'm trying to get out of the trenches. Like, yeah, I'm sitting here just like in the mud.
Exactly. Like, exactly. Yeah.
My heaven's a fucking dirty basement, bitch. Like, what are you talking about, man? There is no heaven for people like us, man.
That's what I'm. It is weird too. Like what you guys were talking about before. Like when I was growing up, like the conservatives were the ones that were like insisting on gender norms and like they were the ones like imposing all this shit. And now it's like what? Like I don't know, that video of like, you know, I don't want to get all Slav mode about it, but like, yeah, that video of like them like telling that kid like, oh, so you don't like these traditionally girly things and you must be a boy. It's like, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, have you ever heard of a tomboy? Like some kids are just tomboys. Like some people are just like that. And some people
just have different interests when they're four than they're going to the rest of their fucking life. Yeah. I've never thought about that too. Holy shit.
And like, some dudes are fucking effeminate and like, yo, mind your own fucking business. Like who cares? Who cares? You know what I mean? Like, why do you need to categorize that as like, oh, so that means you must be this thing. You must fit yourself into this. Mind your own fucking
business. Because it makes you the ultimate consumer. The transgender ideology makes you the ultimate customizable Mr. Potato Head consumer that always has to buy plastic surgery, is you know, totally reliant on pharmaceuticals, doctors. You know, the world will never acclimate itself efficiently enough to accommodate this person, but they spend so much money and they make so much money, you know, selling this idea.
That's a very interesting point because like the transgender thing, like that, you know, if you really want to like, you know, if there's a concern about passing, right, which is also strange to me, like, why do you care about that? Why do you care about that? If you're just you and you just identify that way, you should just be okay with who you are. Why do you need to change who you are to fit something? Why are you worried about that? And then all that stuff costs a lot of money. And it's funny how that gets wrapped into like the healthcare convo or whatever, like universal economic needs of like socialists being like, oh, well, if you really want to care about equal economic opportunity, like you need to make sure you give extra for these people that have these demands, these like consumer demands about changing their appearance or whatever. It's like, yeah, but it's like, But why do you need that? You don't. Why can't you just be okay with who you are? Like, why don't there's no more room for just being like, okay, I'm just myself. You know what I mean? Like, I might not fit into any category or whatever. There's no more of that. Like, you're not allowed to do that. Even for us, like, you know, politically, like, they always want you to like pick an ideology, like pick a brand. It's like, well, what if I don't pick any of these? What about that? It's like, no, you need to pick one. It's like, yo, what the fuck? Who the fuck are you talking about? I can do whatever the fuck I want. I don't need to pick one. I don't need to if I don't want to. So but they always like apply that pressure, and it's a very consumer brain thing. It's like, you need to pick one so you can buy the merch that comes with it. You know what I mean? No. That's really what it is.
Well, these people's worldview and ideology runs on data, right? And like data points.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Like,
algo.
Like facts and shit and algorithms. And
yeah.
You can't run data on people who are in a gray area.
That's exactly
right. You can't
run
data on nuance. Exactly. You can only run data on people and things that are categorized neatly, right? So like, if you can categorize everyone as either non-binary, genderqueer, fucking transgender, or just like actually just like whatever the hell, demisexual shit, like whatever this weird stuff is, you can put everyone onto these weird little boxes and you can run data points on them, and you can get, oh, these people vote in this way and these people support this one thing, and this is how we best reach this market. It's like it is market play.
Absolutely.
At the end of the day.
That's exactly right. Mm. That's exactly right. Yeah. It really is just like, yeah. Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like, how do we know what you're into? How do we know, like, what do you purchase? What do you, where do you, how do you vote? Like, all that stuff is in the data. And it's like, if you don't fit into that, then you're a problem. You're like, you know, a deviation from what they can standardize and just, you know, cater to.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. If you can shift around, and if you're like, you know, general kind of person who can deal in the world of nuance and like understand that you can have, you know, dialectical like takes and opinions on things, and that you're not just exactly one thing, that you can be multiple things at multiple different times, or one specific thing in different times, depending on the circumstance. That's an issue for people like who need everything to be cut and dry and black and white, because like you can't run a moralism thing when you're in the gray area, because like at the end of the day, all of life is in the gray area.
Yep.
There is no cut and dry anything. There's no cut and dry good or bad. There's no cut and dry like this person is a woman or this person is a man, like, as far as gender concepts go, because even that in itself is amalgamous, like not talking about biological sex, just gender concepts, unless you go into setting those strict norms where you can set in groups and out groups, where you can categorize people. And like being in the gray area is a danger for these people, because then you're like, you're someone who they can't account for with their politics. So they can't be sure that you're going to be supportive of their quote unquote progressive goals. They can't be sure that you're not going to be a reactionary domestic terrorist that might roll up on the White House, you know?
Right. Mm-hmm. Jack, do you get that too, of like, as far as ideology as well, just like, oh, you need to fit into some categorization, some box, and like,
yeah, it really infuriates people if you cannot be easily placed into a preconceived category or box, and that's the root of a lot of the hostility that's directed at me. My project online is that it's just very off-putting to unimaginative people because they don't know where to put it.
Especially being a gay man.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that too.
Like, people, libs are like, hey, you should support Biden. You should hate Trump, probably.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, for like, sometimes they'll call me a Nazi, but more recently they've been calling me a member of the dirtbag left.
Well, that's fucked up.
And they're really, yeah.
Don't put that evil on me.
They're just mad about the whole like mishmash of like perfume and like media, and it just really turns them off. Like, there's something about me that just like narrow-minded people, when they see any trace of it, they're just like, oh, I hate this.
It's like a short circuit.
It's just so inconvenient for them.
Right.
You know?
No, our modern world's built on convenience. Like, that's what a consumer society is built on. It's just like how to be the most like comfortable creature of all time, and how to have all your desires and wants the most conveniently like given to you. And most people want and desire to know what the fuck is going on around them, or at least think that they do. And so when someone comes along and it's not convenient to be able to understand what they are, it's gonna make people fucking panic.
Yeah, that's what's so funny. It's like someone like me, like I'm like Asian and Black, like I'm a fairly rare mix, and like if you think about where trajectory of humanity is going, it's gonna be more weird mixes like that. That's just how things are going. And as far as like the internet and everybody like culture sort of like melding and all that stuff and getting these weird like hybrids and all that, like that shit is inevitable. You can't put the brakes on that, just like you can't put the brakes on global capital. That's like a consequence that they have to deal with. And one of those things that comes out of that is that it's getting harder and harder to categorize people, because people are exposed to more shit that they weren't exposed to before 20 years ago, 30 years ago. So I mean, I don't know how they're gonna do. I mean, they'll, you know, somebody up all night thinking about how to adjust to that, but like it's going to be a tough thing for them to deal with, because like it's going to be harder and harder to put people in boxes.
The pre-existing categories are so inapplicable and so dated,
yeah,
and make no sense and have become so exaggerated, where it's just, unless you support every nihilistic black hole thing that liberalism decides, then you're in the bad alt-right white supremacist imaginary holding tank.
Right.
And so these categories are just like, it's literally like the nothing in the never-ending story. Liberalism is like that, where it's just this
never-ending
big black cloud that encompasses everything, and you either comply and you're considered part of the, you know, the good people, or you reject it and you're one of the bad people.
Yeah, it's like the MAGA people, like they're just like, oh well, if you're a right winger, you must be pro-war, right? I mean, that's how I've understood the category for the last couple decades, so that must be how it is now. And it's like, nah, shit has changed. Between there's rifts between the right and the GOP, so like your previous old like categorizations of things don't apply anymore. But they can't get out of that mindset, and like the libs can't do it. I mean, the left can't do it either. It's like they're just like, oh, if you support a Republican, you must be a Reaganite. It's like, damn, like Trump should have already snapped you out of that already. But like they just have these categorizations of like, you know, there's like a set you know, template of beliefs that you must have if you mean
at the most fundamental level, opposing censorship puts you in the category of Nazis, made up category of Nazis.
Oh yeah,
it doesn't make any sense whatsoever that being against censorship, it would align you with Nazi beliefs.
Yeah, authoritarian overreach is somehow synonymous with being against censorship. That just makes no fucking sense. Like, it's crazy. Like, I've had people, I remember I was got into an argument with some people that are acquaintances of mine, like through the music scene here recently. And we were talking about like the parlor thing. And I was just like, cause it got brought up in passing. And I was like, yeah, it's kind of fucked up, you know, like how just watching big tech companies like come together in lockstep to make sure they just can't have that platform on any internet service. And people were like, what, are you some type of fucking Proud Boy or something? I'm like, dude, first of all, what the fuck even is that? Second of all, why can't you just have a nuanced take on something without being one or the other side? Like, I can be a normal fucking person and look at this at its surface value and be like, hey, this is not good, without ascribing to either being like one of these crazy extreme groups of being pro or against it. Like, people just assume if you're not one thing, you're completely the other. And there's just no room for like any sort of, it's not even middle ground, it's just general nuance. Like, there's just no room for people that lie outside of that. It's just, right, forced dichotomy.
Well, yeah, social media is definitely contributing that, because you can either fave or a ratio. If you're on Reddit, you can only upvote or downvote. So it's like, damn, maybe you feel kind of in between about something. Like, well, you can't really, I mean, you got to go into the comments or whatever, but like the whole thing is designed to make your brain a fucking, you know, binary code, you know, fucking machine that you know, that's really what they're like setting you up to be. And like everything is flattened. Everything is bad, like, you know, the worst thing possible, and something that you mildly dislike is flattened. And it's like, I mean, like, how, you know, we're all getting re-engineered that way. It's going to have like long term fucking effects like this. And like, yeah, it's going to be a thing where like, you know, this contributes to the whole thing of like, oh, well, you must be this or that. It's like, yeah,
it's hilarious. It's like, even on like, if you ever see like those like BuzzFeed personality tests or whatever the fuck, to where it's like, you are this character because you like this one thing.
Right.
Questions in that, like in questionnaires on like, if you're trying to figure out like your personality type or whatever, even things like that, going through them is just like, you look at the answers and it's like, are you happy or are you sad? It's like, motherfucker, what? Like,
yeah.
You're both of those things at any given time. What the fuck are you talking about? Like,
well, it's a fear thing too. I mean, like, I've known people in my life that I cared about that like were very caught up in identity and like very concerned about identifying as one thing and like taking on an archetype or whatever. It's like, look, if you're one of these people that's listening or whatever, like, I understand that. Like, it's a terrifying thing to like to not have that, but I mean, yo, you just gotta fucking, I don't know, you just gotta have the balls to just be like, yo, whatever, I don't really know. Nobody knows.
Everyone's a work in progress, right? Everyone's constantly going through their lives. They're adapting to what's changing around them. They're learning new things. They're forgetting old things, whatever. So like, people want to go ahead and rush and get to the end point where they say, I am this one thing.
But right.
You're not any one thing. Like, you're not complete yet. You're still going through it. You're actively establishing what you are. So like, getting fixated on, what am I? Am I this thing? Am I this thing? Am I that thing? It's a fucking trap, because you might alternate between some of those things at different times. You might fucking, like, you're never one thing alone. You're always constantly changing. That's just what life is. That's how like systems operate. Yeah. That's how organisms and life forms move.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It really is. It's a trap. And yeah, it's designed to make you a good consumer. That's really what it is. Like, all that pressure to make you feel that way. Like, it's to make you a good, loyal consumer to something. And like, you don't need to. You just don't need to. I mean, it's comforting and it's easier, but like, you know, you can just, you know, you don't have to. You really don't have to. And you just gotta be comfortable with that shit. And like, I don't know. I mean, that's a tough thing for a lot of people, but like, I don't know. You gotta figure that out on your own, I guess. But I mean, the other thing too is that the other thing that's been like going on is like this heterosexual bashing. I don't know. I saw it from a weird perspective, because I saw it from like people that were like, oh, you know, heterosexuals are getting bashed online or whatever. And I was just like, shut the fuck up. I was just like, you're making us look soft in front of gay people. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I was just like, shut the fuck up. But like,
yeah, motherfucker, straighten up.
But I saw Jack posting about that too. Like, there were like all these articles of like, oh, straight men need to like experiment more. And like, you know, they're like, they're homophobic by nature.
You're like, did a gay man write this?
Well, the people are just living in such a dated and inaccurate and bizarre paradigm that doesn't apply to current reality at all, where, you know, the least homophobic people on earth right now are straight men.
Hey, shout out, hey, like, facts.
Like, nothing, you know, there's this like kind of alliance between regular gay men and straight men just standing up for the most basic form of male sexuality, while everybody else demonizes it to this insane degree, this witch hunt degree. And like, those articles, like, where these little fags write these things about how like, there will never be utopia until straight men experiment with their butts more.
Oh, you know? And my
it's
God.
Like, who's reading this? It doesn't even warrant discussion, because it's so
retarded.
The level of dignity, like, just one more thing on the checklist of things before we achieve utopia.
Right.
It's straight men being forced to put things in their butts.
It's the flip side of the like evangelicals who in the early 2000s and like late 90s and shit are like, well, you shouldn't be putting things in your butts, like, like, we gotta tell you what you can do in the bedroom. And now it's just the other side. It's like, no, now we're telling straight men what to do in the bedroom.
But like, it's so disconnected from any kind of sexual reality, because libs are so antiseptic, anti-sex. It's also like theoretical and abstract, and they're terrified of any trace of actual eroticism or sexuality. So it just all of this abstract, like fat chicks with blue hair saying there's this, that, and the other thing. And none of it has anything to do with the actual libidinal reality of human sexuality. You know?
Yeah. I feel like it's what's very strange is like this is part of like this like thing where the hyper reality everyone is like sold doesn't actually match up with the actual material reality that we're existing in.
Right.
And it's like I feel like we live in a very overtly sexual, like psychosexual society as far as like culturally, but very repressed sexually as far as like actual sex goes. Yeah. Like any type of like actual sex act is generally kind of like
frowned upon.
Taboo or frowned upon, depending unless it's like done in a specific way that's thought up by these specific people. But you can write about all this crazy, like you have people that are like putting hashtag kink and shit in their bio that are people who never get any pussy or never get any dick. And you're like, okay, what world are you living in right now?
None of that is real. None of it's real. And this is a fundamental misunderstanding on both sides of the political spectrum, because like right-wing guys tend to think that they have this like wish fulfillment image of the left as being this like nonstop Sodom and Gomorrah orgy, which is not true. They're not having sex. Like none of it is actual sex. It's just like how they think that like white girls will like go to college and have these nonstop orgies because of like liberalism or something. It's just fantasy, a pornographic fantasy. Nobody's having any sex.
Yeah, yo. I mean, well, the stats are there as far as our millennial generation. Like, it's already locked in on the stats. But like, this is a point that like same meme I brought up, and shout out him. Like, I wish he'd come back to Twitter because he was always fucking fire. But like, it's the same thing. It's just like this idea of like, the right are all incels or whatever. It's like, damn, man. I get like he was making this point. Like, I get that vibe from the left. I get that vibe from the left a lot, like this really bitter incel energy. And like, I'm not gonna condemn anyone just for not having sex or whatever, because that's tied to material things. I mean, it's reality, however anybody feels about it. Like, if the economy's bad, less people are gonna be, you're gonna have less resources to like to fuck or whatever. Like, I mean, but like, you know, they just pin it as like only a right wing thing. But I've felt that energy on the left a lot, just like this really bitter incel rage from these dudes. Like, that's a real thing. It's a real fucking thing. And it's like, I don't know. I've definitely noticed that. I don't know if other people have, but like, I've definitely noticed that.
No, dude, there's like crazy incel motherfuckers that are just like they'll be like in Amy's replies or something, being like, I hope you get raped or killed or shit. Like,
at the same time
posting like hashtag Me Too shit about like some dumb broad in Hollywood.
Yeah. They have no outlet for sexuality. Like, libs, they're so cloistered and repressed that their only kind of outlet for sexuality is their spectral rape online pylons, finding a bad person and attacking them in a really grotesque ways under the guise of morality. That's where liberal sexuality has been channeled. It's a sexual act for them.
Yeah.
It really is like rape, you know, and Me Too has ensured that like none of the physical reality of rape occurs, but this online version of rape where it's just ganging up on someone who's considered bad. It's the liberal version of sexuality.
That's a good point. And also, like, this shit is not conducive to sex. Like, I don't know about everybody else, but like in sexual situations, it's usually people putting their guards down, being vulnerable to each other, like to some degree. I don't know how you can do that with somebody who's like a super wokey, you know what I mean? Like scolding somebody like, oh, this is the wrong way to do this, or this is the improper, you know, this is inappropriate, or everything's wrong and everything's immoral, and like, oh, you need triple enthusiastic consent and like three NDA signed before you can fucking touch each other. Like, you know what I mean? Like, none of that shit is conducive to sex. So I don't understand. Like, yeah, it is interesting.
I think I think that's why this incel thing is such a like a quote unquote more like modern phenomena, but and that's so widespread. Like, and you're mentioning it's on the left and it's on the right. It's fucking everywhere because of the fact that they put sex under such a microscope and they make it so like they sexualize everything in the media and on like the internet and then everything you watch, and they tell you like, well, if you're not having sex these like extravagant crazy ways and you're just not doing it, and if you're not experimenting with guys, if you're a straight man, then you're just not doing it right. Meanwhile, most of these people can't even find a guy to experiment with if they wanted to or find any pussy to fuck. Like, it's like there's really just like such a divide between what the expectations are being built up by this fake reality and what's actually materially available to people that you get so much sexual repression. Like, you have such a high population of people that are just sexually repressed while living in an overtly sexual society at this surface level. And it's like, you're going to just get that. Like, it's, they're so pinched on like categorizing sex and like examining it and stuff rather than just letting it play out.
Well, Japan has this problem with you know, they were deep in the, you know, they were deep in like financial bubbles in the 90s. Like, they were a little bit like a decade ahead of like our bubbles and all that. Like, you know, they have the same thing of like super sexual repression and like, you know, weird fetishes that come out of that. Like, they were already like type of on that vibe. Oh, yeah. And yeah, I mean, that is a thing where if you're alienated, nobody's fucking, if you're alienated, you know what I mean? If you have widespread alienation and from economic collapse, that's not conducive to people fucking, you know what I mean? That's just, and they already have you know, it's a mainstream thing to say that, like, you know, the younger people aren't like fucking like that. And it's like, yeah, I mean, that's a real thing that's tied to that. It's like, yeah. And then you get all these weird like proclivities sexuality wise. And it's, I don't know, it's the weirdest thing
because
I've sensed.
It's so removed from the actual reality of the act that you get these like absurd fanfic type sexualities that aren't even actually sex at all. Like,
yep, that's it. And it's the weirdest thing I felt like from the left, where like, oh, you know, it's like a shameful thing to be like horny or whatever. Like, the left like pushes that, and it feels like very like Christian right wing from the old days, you know what I mean? Like, it always felt like that. I'm like, what is behind that? But it would always feel like very contradictory to like the OnlyFans thing. So I just didn't get like how you could push both of those things. But I would get that vibe from the left a lot. I don't know how to reconcile that. But I think, yeah, I think what you're saying makes sense. But like, it's a very weird like double talk, you know what I mean? Double messaging that goes
bureaucratic organization of something that cannot be defined or demystified, human sexuality. And so they, you know, there's always more progress to be made until utopia is achieved. Right. So if they organize every kink, every fetish into something safe, something contained, then we'll be closer to utopia. And it's an absolute disaster. And Camille Paglia's main thesis in Sexual Personae that transgenderism, cross-dressing, and sadomasochism are things that occur at the end of a civilization. That's what we're living through right now. Even the COVID mandates and everything are a form of sadomasochism because we're in such an insanely sexually repressed era to a degree that has not been seen, you know, since before the 20th century. People are so sexually repressed. And what's worse is they don't even realize it. They think that they're living through an era of sexual liberation.
Yeah.
But it is absolutely the most draconian anti-sex era that, you know,
I think
anyone has ever seen.
Yeah, I think you guys cleared up some shit in my head, because like I just had real trouble reconciling this shit. But like, yeah, it really is a thing where it's just like people aren't actually fucking, but they're in their heads with porn or OnlyFans or like these sexual identities. They're in their heads doing all this stuff. So like maybe they feel the release, or like they're gratified by it in some way, but they're not really doing it for real. So like that's
well, also like as they keep putting sex under a microscope, and specifically different types of sex, be it like more traditionally taboo types of sex and kink and stuff like that, and they start bringing it more into the accepted norms, and they try to quote unquote normalize kink and blah blah blah.
Right.
What it does is it takes away like the taboo aspect of it that somewhat was drawing people to that in the first place. And so people are going to get pushed towards more and more taboo things and towards actual degenerative actions and stuff that are counter to good humanity and just growth and progress in general. And you'll just start seeing more recessive trends.
Right, right. Like, yeah, yeah. I mean, the polycule thing, like, I guess I've met a couple people who do that, but like, yeah, I guess there's some argument to be made of that, of like people who just sort of like are just doing things that are so removed from like what intimacy is, like the opposite of intimacy, that like they're just sort of like, it's like cold and calculated and just like, oh yeah, you're fucking someone else after you fuck me. Like,
oh whatever. My god, like, holy fuck, that reminds me of the, okay, this morning, sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No,
I
no.
saw this article on the Economist or whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
Whatever that, it's some like publication media thing, but it was like, let me see if I can pull it up exactly real quick, but it's talking about how more and more young people are using spreadsheets to organize and determine their love life.
Fuck out of here. Yo, yo.
What the fuck does that even mean? Spreadsheets? What? Like, I'm talking about, what the fuck?
Oh, what is even their love life? Like,
yeah, no, it's, there's no love. I've
gotten into it from like seeing what Zoomer girls do, where they have this like prostitution gig on the side where they make some money to travel and everything via sugar daddy, and then they like fuck younger guys on Tinder and the guys are never good enough. It's like, ugh, it,
damn,
it's very bleak. Yeah. I don't even know what romance is anymore, what that constitutes.
Right.
Well, if you organize your love life onto a spreadsheet, it'll be a lot easier when it comes time to collect your dues for OnlyFans and also to just import your love life directly up into the cloud, because you can just upload your spreadsheet in there and then just have your virtual love life floating around. Then you don't even need to go have sex anymore.
Right, right, right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, everything's commodified. It's only cool if it's commodifiable. Like everything else that's more like intimate, organic, like that might be taboo or just irrelevant or whatever, but anything that can be commodified or put into data to like whatever, that's okay. Like that's what's acceptable. Yeah, it's very bizarre. But yeah, I think we lost Slav. Slav got his power cut out, but he really wanted to ask you, Jack, about, before we go, of like, he wanted to ask like, what do you think the artistic legacy of COVID will be, as far as like, I think that's a question that comes up with like the Trump thing too, of like, oh, like would Trump be good for art? I remember that was like a big thing before Trump got elected, and like, you
hell
know,
no, he wasn't.
You know, I completely disagree.
I think that in order for anything good or productive or interesting to happen with art, the entire legacy of the 2010s will have to be undone. People have to mentally remove themselves from all of the propaganda that they've been subjected to for the last 11, 12 years. They have to realize that is, none of it is real, that Me Too is not real, that Black Lives Matter is not real, that COVID is not real. Until that happens, you're not going to have any good art. And the reason that movies and everything is so bad is because it does not speak to the current moment or anyone's experience right now, because speaking to people's actual experience and the total repression that we're living through right now is stigmatized as white supremacist, Nazi, evil.
Yep.
So
exactly.
Until someone grows some balls and is able to put forth a realistic interpretation of what is going on right now that is not liberal propaganda, we won't have any good art.
Yep. Yeah. And it's,
I think that there's a lot of truth to that.
Absolutely. And like I listen to a lot of rap, and rap is supposed to be the most fucking subversive shit, you know what I mean? Well, now it's not, because it's the most popular genre, but you know, the origins of it are very subversive, and like there's a lot of fucking rap, like even from like hood ass rappers that like are just lit bullshit, like just like about COVID or whatever, like a lot of, or BLM or whatever, like a lot of it is that. And like the thing with that is, the bag drive, right? Like, they just want the bag. They want the money. And the money is where you push the lib mainstream shit that the rich people want you to push, and then you get the money for it. So they do that. I don't know if regular people believe that. I don't think they really do, but, like, that's where the incentive is. And, like, you know, the other thing with, like, all art in general, like, I don't know, in my mind, it's like, you know, the heads of the movie execs or whatever who decide what films get, like, greenlit or whatever, and music and art in general, like, these guys, they don't give a fuck about the art. Like, they don't, it's been a while like this. It's not even a recent thing. Like, they don't care about that shit. So, like, they're in it for the
art is actively demonized. Like, you know, this goes along with the whole pro-censorship sentiment that normal people have. Is like, art or anything that is complex or problematic is stigmatized as being bad. And so we have 10 years of people conditioned to think that art is only good if it explicates a utopian ideal.
There's nothing human about it. Like, comedians or whatever, like just admitting some flawed fucked up thinking that you have that's problematic, like just something human that, like, hey, maybe we all think and we all admit, like, damn, I shouldn't think like that, but it's funny that I do. Like, it's, you know, I know it's wrong, but whatever, it's funny. That human thing is just gone. Like, there's nothing, you can't do that. You can't express that. Like, it's wrong to just convey that. And, you know, them trying to erase everything in the history that had any problematic origins that might be human, that's got to be all scrubbed and replaced with, like, utopian shit that's alien, completely alien, and nowhere near
anyone's
life.
Until people get some balls, and, you know, we're not going to see anything good. And I'm just exhausted at this point. I don't really want to stick around for everybody's little realization that liberalism has been evil and wrong and fascist the entire time.
Right.
I don't have all that much hope. But, you know, until people grow some balls and tell the truth publicly, we won't have anything good.
Yeah, I think that, like, generally as a whole, like what y'all are saying is all very correct. Like, capitalism and just, like, consumer society and just profit itself is, like, dehumanizing. So it's going to take away the human aspect that is needed to create good art. And it doesn't incentivize actual good art. It just incentivizes art that sells, and art sells to people who are good consumers. And so the art that's going to sell is going to be the stuff that appeals mostly to these lib brain consumer types in the mainstream. So because of that, we just have, like, irredeemably shitty cultural stuff coming out, art, like Saturday Night Live bullshit, all of that. But I think at the same time, that lack of any substance in the mainstream, that, like, just hugely devoid of anything that has any meaningful critique or any humanity in it, I think that pushes a lot of innovation for people who do actually care about art, for people who do actually still have their humanity in them, and people who still want to create in spite of that. I think it causes a little bit of, like, a renaissance type feeling of people that want to create in spite of the shit that's out there. You just have to poke around and look for it a lot more. And I think that, like, with the COVID stuff, like, yeah, it's miserable watching, like, the fucking Netflix TV shows and promos they're putting out for stuff that's come out during this pandemic. It's all, like, movies about dating someone through a computer screen and shit like that.
Oh boy.
But I also think that this has worsened material conditions for so many people, and it's going to continue that way. And people's material conditions are going to get so much worse, and people are going to be suffering on a daily basis at levels that they haven't before. And I think that from great suffering comes great art, oftentimes. Sure. And from great turmoil and through great adversity comes really, really great art. And I think that that's going to happen. You're not going to see that on Netflix, probably. You're not going to, like, Sarah Cooper or whoever the fuck isn't going to put out any good art because this bitch isn't suffering. But there are people who right now have nothing to their name, and they have nothing other than playing a keyboard to drive them. And there's nothing other that they have except for comfort of making some type of painting or singing a song or whatever the fuck it is. God, hell, even making a podcast, whatever the fuck, you know, that I think that there will be some good stuff that will come out of this. It's just like, right, you're gonna have to look for it.
Yeah. I think that's a major drive for why I'll say like wild shit on Twitter, like even shit that like maybe I didn't think out thoroughly or like maybe isn't even like the most like, you know, polished or whatever. Like sometimes I'll just be like, fuck it, whatever. Like I'm just tired of the fucking dullness, the monotony. Mm-hmm. I'm just tired of that shit. And like sometimes that pushes me to just say shit that I wouldn't normally say, or maybe I don't even fully stay on just because it's like, dude, anything. Like I'm bored. You know what I mean? Like I used to hear rap that was like some shit that like I, you know, it's just weird shit that like you just normally wouldn't hear. Or like, I used to be around like rappers in Brooklyn or like artists, art scene people in Brooklyn, like, you know, not even just necessarily them, but like shit that I would hear that was like different or weird that never got put on. And like, there's no incentive for that because it's a business risk. If you're just thinking about it from business perspective, the people that run this, why would you take a financial risk? You're just going to do what's safe and standardized, and that's what you're going to do to make the most money. It's only good business sense. And if these people don't actually care about the art, why would you expect them to do anything differently? But like, yeah, I mean, yeah. It just creates a boredom where it's just like, damn, man, I just want to hear anything raw. I don't care if I disagree with it. That's why I'm cool. That's why I like people who I, you know, on the right that I disagree with about a lot of shit. Like, I still like it because, damn, at least it's fucking real. Like, I just need to hear something real. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. Mm-hmm. Anything to break through that fucking monotony. That shit is dead, man. That shit is soul crushing. For real. Like, that's what it is. Like, it's all throughout all the art now. It's just very, like, dead, soul crushing shit. Like, mm-hmm. It's bleak.
Yeah. And you gotta poke around and find the shit that's not. And then you have to support that shit while you can.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Buy the FedPost merch.
Buy the FedPost merch on grip.shop. Yeah.
Subscribe to the Perfume Nationalist. Get on that shit. Go.
Please subscribe while it's here.
Yeah, for real. But yeah, next time we'll get Slav on to, because he definitely wants to talk to you some more, because he's got more.
Yeah, absolutely.
The culture takes.
I'll come back anytime. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man. Appreciate you coming on. That was great.
Yeah, that's good talk.
Yeah, thanks, man. Have a good day.
Well, happy you Valentine's too. Day, boys.
Oh yeah,
happy Valentine's Day.
Hey, all right, man. See you guys.
All right, see ya.